97 and 103.7 WTIB present Talk of the Town with Henry Hinton. News, sports, and community information, and everything that's going on around town. Now, with Talk of the Town, here's your host, Henry Hinton.
Okay, welcome back. It's the Talk of the Town here on Monday morning. It's the 13th day of January. Welcome in, everybody. Good to be here this morning. 4 minutes after 8 o'clock, and a lot going on around town. We got a lot to talk about this hour, and it's good to have you with us. McGee is here with Sports Today, and we've been talking about sports a lot because it was a big sports weekend. Not such a great sports weekend, but a big sports weekend. And also at the news desk this morning, Lindsay Fry is here from WITN. Good morning, Lindsay.
Good morning.
How are you? Nice to see you.
It's great to be here.
Everything going well?
It's great.
Good. Everything good down at WITN?
Oh, yeah.
You got things under control down there?
We're trying to.
All right, good. And the forecast for today, we're going up into the mid-60s today. Saw one forecast had the expected high at 64, and the forecast I've got here in front of me says a high of 66. Mine always says higher than the other one that I read. The one we should be listening to is Jim Howard and Marvin Daugherty, maybe. And Matt Engelbrecht. Maybe we'll check up with, you know what, Michael, let's try to get Jim on the phone anyway, because I want to ask him about the forecast the rest of the week. The polar vortex is now gone. And we have had warm weather the last 2 days. I went over the Panthers game yesterday, and it was an absolutely perfect day for football yesterday. It felt like, I told my wife, it felt like early November.
Yeah. It looked like it was,
and
really nice.
There was not a cloud in the sky. It was a beautiful day. And if we had only played that well, the Panthers had only played like as good as the weather was. But today's going to be kind of like that. And then rain comes in tomorrow. We got like a quarter of an inch of rain moving in tomorrow. And then by Thursday, temperatures are going to drop back down into the 40s. And there's actually, my forecast is saying that there could be some snow in the forecast toward the end of the week. So I'm hoping that's not the case. But we'll just have to wait and see. A lot of other things going on. The city council will meet tonight. And it looks like they're going to talk about the town common master plan. There's been so much talk about what to do with the town common, and the town common has become over the years kind of the place to hang out if you're here in town on the 4th of July. They do a good job with the 4th of July celebration. We've got Sunday in the park. But you know, there's a great amount of land down there, and then beyond that you have the rest of the river. And the question that's always being raised is, can the city of Greenville utilize the waterway that we have now? And when you think about that, you know, I think about the Tar River, and I think it looks like a big ditch, right? It looks like a big ditch with nasty water in it. That's what it looks like. But when I was in college, Lindsay, you'd be interested to know that my roommate and I once we went and got one of these big inner tubes, and we actually floated down the Tar River.
You know, they still do that. Clayton and everyone at the station every summer, yeah, they still float it.
I mean, and so there's not a lot of recreational use for the Tar River now. But you know, the question that keeps coming up: could there be? And they've hired this consultant, and they were going to pay him like $185,000 to come in. And I've heard a lot of complaining about that, saying, why are we spending $185,000 on a consultant? Well, if you take a look at what they did in Greenville, South Carolina, or even on a much larger scale, how about what they've done in San Antonio, Texas, where you've got this natural resource running right through the middle of your town. Now, keep in mind, in 1999, it did flood the whole city. Well, it flooded the other side of the city.
Right.
It flooded the north side, was totally flooded. But could you actually take the Tar River and do something with it that would become a positive for the community? Can you ever envision shops and walkways and restaurants and things like that overlooking the river down around the town common. So there's been some discussion about, well, we should develop the town common because that's a great spot to develop with that kind of a thing. Now, the other point of view is that, you know, why would you ever take this one big, huge, beautiful piece of green space that Greenville has and let developers get their hands on it? And you know what? I actually see both points of view. I actually see both points of view. I don't know what the answer is, but they're going to come back tonight. The Town Common Master Plan, which is just a little bit over 3 years ago, 3 years old, and there was a lot of extensive public input in it, is going to be back on the table tonight at the Greenville City Council meeting. I would love to hear what you think should be done with the town common. You know, I am not so opposed to having some development of the town common, as long as it was the right kind of development. And now the tree huggers will go nuts that I've said that, because they'll start saying, "Well, why? There goes another Republican saying we ought to just take all the green space out." I didn't say that. But I do believe that there, you know, that as we look at the downtown Greenville area and all the emphasis that's been placed on it and all the money that's been spent on it, we've got to continue to do something downtown Greenville to try to bring it back and turn it into something different than what it's been over the years. You know, we've got some crime issues down there and those kind of things. You know, McGee, I don't know if you've noticed that downtown Charlotte, they're building a brand new baseball park right next to Bank of America Stadium. And, mm-hmm. and you know, that's where the Charlotte minor league baseball team is going to play. Mm-hmm. I could almost envision there being a major league baseball team in Charlotte at some point in the future. You think that's possible?
Possible.
Possible.
I've been to a Charlotte Knights game, and they play way out of the city.
Yeah, they do.
Now, but they're going to bring it right into the heart of the city. I think that's probably a good thing.
Can a baseball team survive with the Bobcats and the Panthers? No, I don't think so, but... If one of those two go.
Well, the Panthers aren't really what you call surviving.
Well.
Are they?
Well, I don't know. For the next few years, they'll be, anyway.
By the way, we were in a suite yesterday. I was a guest of the Panthers yesterday, and we were in a suite two doors down from Michael Jordan's suite. I've been in a suite before.
Really?
I've talked about it. Yeah, but he wasn't in it yesterday.
Ah.
But I saw a bunch of people. I think some of his family was in there yesterday.
Huh.
I think his brother might have been in there.
Very cool.
But, you know, I've been in that suite before when Michael was two doors down. And when he's in the suite, there's security outside the door.
So you would know.
There was no security out there yesterday. So, didn't see Michael. But I know the Bobcats played on Saturday night. And they might have had a game Sunday night. I don't know. But back to the town common. Would you be averse? Let's open up the phone lines. What do you think? 561-8255. Would you be averse to seeing some development on the town common? Do you think that the natural resource that we have there can be utilized for the betterment of the community? Is it time for us to do something different with the town common? Or is what we're doing enough, just having it there for people to play in the park, throw the frisbee, walk the dog? And then, you know, as a rule, the community doesn't use it that much. It's being used by, you know, it's being used 4th of July, and it's being used,
used for
Sunday in the park and some other special events.
Marathon events that are being ran.
Some 5K races and things like that. 561-8255, 561-8255. It looks like Marion Blackburn, the council person, has asked that this be put back on the agenda tonight. And so whatever decision was made 3 years ago, you kind of get the feeling we may be going in a different direction with this city council. 561-8255, 561-8255. What do you think about Greenville's town common? Should we look at doing some development there? Sean, you're on. How are you?
No, I think we need to leave it alone. I mean, the Tar River is a dump right along in there. They used the historic town creek, to quote what they were doing, to put $1 million bridge across a drainage ditch. All they're doing is blowing our money.
So you can't, there's no situation that you could envision where Greenville could do what Greenville, South Carolina has done and utilize it as an economic developer and a driver to create jobs and see restaurants and shops and things like that along the waterfront.
No, we have restaurants and shops and everything all over Greenville. Why do we need to take a piece of, you know, nature and do this? Right across the river, we have River Park North. You know, we have all this residential
which nobody uses, by the way.
And so we're encroaching our residential with business.
Yeah, yeah. So you'd be totally opposed to this?
Yes.
Okay.
And, I mean, you know, Joni Mitchell said it real good. Take paradise and put up a parking lot.
She did. That's exactly what she said back in the 70s. All right.
Yeah.
And okay, thank you, Sean. Appreciate it. 561-8255. 561-8255. Tell me again, Coach. Ernie is there. Good morning, Ernie. How are you?
Good morning, Henry. How are you?
I'm good.
You know, we had this problem in Memphis, too, and developed Mud Island from it. And what they were trying to do is to redo the downtown river park and make it into something commercial. And what they decided on is to go with Mud Island, which is right across the way. And when you talk about taking the front river park, you always talk about that particular piece of green. Why not look across the river and develop that side of the river into a rather large amphitheater where you could bring in concerts, you could connect it with a long bridge, as we did a third of a mile, long bridge connected Memphis to Mud Island. And also, you would start using that side of the river for economic development. There's always been the argument, nothing ever happens north of the river. Here's your chance.
You know, there's something very appealing about what you're saying there, Ernie, but, you know, I would have to say that side of the river is where the flood took place. And so, you know, if you're going to pour public resources into doing something down there, is it too risky to do it over on the side of the river that we, you know, of course, I know they call it the 500-year flood, but, you know, even if we have a 100-year flood again or a 50-year flood, that part of the city is very susceptible to being flooded again. So, you know, you have to worry about that if you're going to do something on the other side of the river, don't you?
Well, you had to build it up. I mean, you're not going to just leave it on the level that it is.
Yeah.
You build it up with a bluff on that side because the bluffs do work. Memphis is affidavit to that. And I think it's a better opportunity across the river, maintaining the green space, and starting to develop where development can happen, and the land's going to be much cheaper.
I remember when the flood happened, Stan, what's his name? The geologist. He's a famous geologist at ECU. What is his name? Somebody call and refresh my memory on Stan's name. I've met Stan several times, and he's one of the top geologists in the country. We were lucky to have him here at East Carolina. He spoke to the city council after the flood, and this is what he said about future development.
Stan Riggs,
yeah. Well, Stan's comment about developing things on the other side of the river particularly, he said, you need to understand that the river basin is the river basin. The river is the river, and the river basin is the river basin. And you can share the river basin with the river. In other words, you could put houses and buildings and things like that in there, and you can share it, but you need to understand when the river comes and they decide they're going to share it with you, they're going to take you out. And so when you develop in the river basin and in the watershed area, you're really putting your investment dollars at risk. And so I think even if you built up a particular area of that side of the river, Ernie, and tried to turn it into something, I don't know how you could protect it for the long haul if you had another huge flood. I don't know that you could. But
well, you know, we're talking about the Mississippi River when we talk about Memphis. It makes the Tar River look like a creek.
Yeah.
And they took Mud Island, and somebody took me and showed me this back in June last year because I did not know about all the development. But you wouldn't believe how an entire community, they have over 1,000 housing and apartment developments on that island.
Yep.
That used to flood.
Right.
But they did what they had to do. And when, you know, think about it this way, every time Minnesota flushes, the river rises in Memphis. And
that's
we're
true.
Talking the Mississippi River, not the
Park. And I've been there. I've been to Mud Island. I've been on that side of the river. I've kind of stood out on, you know, there's a lot of concrete there.
Oh, yeah.
There's a lot of concrete there. You're talking about a major city in Memphis, and there's a lot of concrete. I'm not sure that, you know, that you're talking about the kind of investment dollars there that, you know, that I don't know where that kind of money would come from to develop this side, that side of the river. But you know, again, I'm intrigued by your idea, and I appreciate your input.
Thank you, sir.
All right. Good talking to you. 561-8255, 561-8255, the Greenville City Council. Tonight, we'll undertake the issue of what to do, if anything, with the Greenville Town Common tonight. Roscoe, good morning. How are you?
Good morning, Henry. I listen to you every morning.
Well, thank you.
My opinion for Greenville is, instead of spending this money on these studies for these projects along the river, they need to pay someone to come in and do a traffic study to get the traffic flow in Greenville to where it can support this additional development.
Mm-hmm.
Greenville is a real hodgepodge of traffic.
Yeah.
They have no plans whatsoever. They built that Regency Parkway. It's fantastic, but it goes nowhere.
Yeah.
I use it every morning, and it's a great country.
People may not even know what you're talking about, Regency Parkway. It's interesting that you say, you know, for a minute I had to stop and think, where is that? You're talking about the cut through now between Memorial Drive and Evans Street.
Correct.
Right before you get to Pitt Community College.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you're right. I've actually been on that. That's a beautiful little four-lane parkway there.
I used it.
And there's almost no traffic on it. But let me say this, Roscoe. I don't 100% agree with you, because there are two major road projects underway in Greenville right now that are going to change traffic patterns and I think help quite a bit. Now, I'm like you. On Friday afternoon, I get on Greenville Boulevard and I want to pull my hair out. It's very frustrating to be on Greenville Boulevard with all the traffic, and you know, you hit every stoplight, and it takes forever to get up and down Greenville Boulevard. And you know, in a town this size, you would think you shouldn't have that kind of problem. However, keep in mind, the Southwest Bypass is coming. That money is allocated. It's on the transportation plan. But here's the big one, in my opinion, that I think is going to change, that's going to be really transformational for Greenville, which is the 10th Street Connector. I don't know if you've actually... A former city councilman, Max Joyner, and I rode over the holidays. We were killing some time, and we rode through the area where they're buying the land to build the 10th Street Connector. And all of a sudden, I can start to envision what that's going to be like and what it's going to look like, and it's going to be great. It's going to be terrific, and it's going to be a very good conduit between the center city and the medical area, and you're going to be able to get on all 10th Street and just drive and keep going. And here's what I hope about the 10th Street Connector: I hope they don't gum it up with a bunch of stoplights, and you're going to be able to drive right out to the medical center, and that's going to change things a lot. And you know what, Roscoe, I think it's going to take a lot of traffic off Greenville Boulevard, which I'm excited about.
Yeah, it probably will, but a lot of these intersections on these new roads, they need to put in small clover leaves, or rather than to have stoplights on these new streets, so your ingress and egress is much quicker and safer.
Yeah, exactly.
But Greenville and the downtown area just needs, the vision of shops and things along the waterway are fantastic. It'd be like... the old canal that runs through Georgetown in Washington, D.C. I mean, it's very picturesque. It's beautiful. It's a nice place to walk. But, again, you know, you got to have places for people to drive and park. And the parking garage is a great idea.
Yeah.
I mean, if when you're putting cars on top of cars, it's taking less space. It costs money.
So you would be
right
okay.
Now, the money. Pardon?
Go ahead.
I said, right now is the time to do it if things are not getting less expensive. And guess what? if a good construction project came in and all these things started moving, you might be able to get some people back to work.
Yeah. So you would be, you would not be opposed to some development on the town common?
No, I think it needs to be looked at, you know, with a lot of logic. You know, what you're talking about, the floodplain, I worked in that field for years, and you just don't mess with the river. You stay on this side of it and let the river and use it at your safest points.
Yeah. All right. Well, that's interesting, Roscoe. I mean, I tend to lean a little bit toward what you're talking about. I think it's going to make the, tree huggers crazy that even talk about building anything on the town common, because the last
trees
time
are crop.
The last time this came up, I mean, there was so much screaming about, oh my God, there go the crazy developers trying to take the beautiful parks and develop and that kind of thing. And listen, I don't want that to happen. I don't want to see a bunch of gummed up condos and things like that there. But to develop it with some, you know, something like maybe the Georgetown shops down on the you mentioned Georgetown.
D.C.,
but I'm thinking about the Georgetown shops down the way it used to be down around where the Chico's area is. I mean, to build some nice restaurants and shops and things like that along the waterway, I think there could be some positives in that. And so now all you liberals, have at me. I know you're going to be crushing me over saying that. All right, thank you, Roscoe.
Well, you're welcome. Take care.
All right, 561-8255. Coach, when you're talking, when I'm talking, I can't hear you. Who'd you say? Oh, Dennis Mitchell, former Greenville City Council member Dennis Mitchell, who took a lot of heat about this subject about 2 years ago. Good morning, Dennis.
Good morning, Henry.
All right, now, you're no longer a city councilman, and one of the things that they beat you up on was the fact that you wanted to develop the town common. And you actually never said you wanted to develop the town common, but a lot of people said that you did.
Yeah, because the river study, of course, was my initiative, and it was after visiting Greenville, South Carolina.
Yeah.
There's a lot of things that we can do with our river to enhance it, to make development more, you know, more likely to happen around it. For instance, we talk about town commons. If we enhance town commons without even actually putting buildings on it, it'll probably make the First Street area more attractive to shops and things like that. And what people just got to realize is it's a great asset for the community. There's really only two places you can see that, the Dog Park, Town Commons, and crossing both bridges. And if we open this river up and allow the community to see the beauty, developers love to develop around the water because people love to live around the water. So even though a lot of it is in the floodplain and things like that, there's ways that we can enhance it, open it up so the residents can have more access to it, that developers are likely to come around it and start wanting to build around it. The town commons has always been a hot-button issue. I don't understand why, like you explained, it's a highly underutilized space. I'm not saying that we should pave it over with concrete, but I think people can probably look at it from all angles and realize that there's some low-impact things that we can do that probably enhance it and cause more citizens to come downtown and cause more developers to want to develop downtown to be closer to the river.
Well, you know, one of the other big things that's missing in this discussion is the amount of land down there, Dennis. I think there could be some development right along the walkway of the riverfront, and keep a tremendous amount of the green space the way it is, and let people enjoy that. But I mean, I think again that would enhance. I think more people would use the green space if there was more activity down there, if there was some other things. Now, I would be totally opposed to going in there and putting a bunch of housing and things like that. I don't think that makes any sense. But right along the river, some restaurants, some shops, some cool areas for people to visit when they come to Greenville. I mean, right now, when people come to Greenville, you know, so show me the cool places in town. Where do you take them? Where do you take
a little,
you know,
Washington? We take a little Washington.
Well,
look,
you know, that's the thing. I mean, you could almost see this becoming a little bit of a touristy kind of an area that we currently don't have. I mean, you can take them and show them the university, And the fact that it is in such close proximity to the university, you could see it being utilized there as well. But, you know, all you're going to hear from the other side, from the people who want this not to happen, is, you know, greed. You use the term developers, which becomes a bad word immediately when people hear that. You know, this to me is about development. It's about economic development. It's about doing something positive for all of us that live here. And I don't know what Marion Blackburn's reason for bringing this back up tonight at the city council, but I'm thinking that there are probably some people that just, you know, want to kill this once and for all and just have no discussion about using the river for any kind of development.
And that's what we had to do in order to get the river study to pass, is to make sure that it was clear that we excluded the town common for it, which I think was a disservice, because part of the river study is figuring out how to come up with a plan financially to make this stuff happen.
Right
now, we got a $13 million town commons master plan on there that has no chance of getting built because we don't have the money for it.
Right.
Because the council that passed it didn't put a plan in place to enact it. And here we also got to be clear that this current plan that they have has buildings on town commons. They forget when they talk about it, it has buildings.
Yeah.
It's civic type buildings. It's not any type of private buildings, but it has buildings on it already.
Right.
So it's important for the public to know that it already does it. It'll be a missed opportunity if we don't utilize this great asset the way San Antonio, Texas has, Greenville, South Carolina, Richmond, Virginia. Cities all across the nation utilize the river to make major attractions for the city, and it enhances the overall quality of life.
You know, I could see a circular walkway down there with a waterfall, with some, you know, kind of as the centerpiece, kind of an area to sit and enjoy the river and that kind of thing. I mean, I think there's some things you could do to really make it nice. But again, you know, the liberals are going to start screaming, the Republicans want to take away all the parks in the green space. And so, you know. All right, man. Good to hear from you. Thank you.
Nice to see you too.
All right, we'll get one more in, and we got to get some news headlines in. 561-8255. Who we got? Stan. Good morning, Stan.
Hey, Henry. How you doing this morning?
Good. Thanks for calling.
I was calling. I don't agree with you on a lot of things, but that's one thing I do agree with you on. We should do something down at the town commons. But the first thing we should do is start at 264 Martin Luther King and go all the way out to 264 out by the Hastings Ford area and do away with these earthen berms that the state and DOT have built to block all that water that flows through this town. Mm. I was affected by the flood in 1999 across the river. I had a great big mobile home park that was completely underwater. That water didn't have anywhere to flow because it was backed up from so many places. You know, they open up the area down at Grimes, and now where water can flow freely. But I think we do need to build something on the town commons and on the other side of the river as well.
Well, you know,
it needs to be done with private funds, Henry. I understand the city wants to put in money for studies and stuff, but we need to get private people involved as well and not spend so much of the city's money. I'm totally in agreement that we need to do something down. We got a beautiful area downtown. I remember when Sycamore Church was down there and all the shacks were down there when I was a young kid.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, those little walkways and stuff that we have there now, it only accommodates a very few people. And I hate to say it because, you know, somebody's going to not like it, but it's mostly the tree huggers and the tree lovers. They go down there in the walk areas and, you know, they have town in the park down there, the city in the park or whatever.
Yeah, Tom Lamprecht.
Tom
Lamprecht just sent me a text that says, "Is River Park North directly across from the town common?" And it kind of is. I believe.
Kind of is. If you're facing, if you're in the town commons, it's kind of down to the right. You know, I grew up in the Meadowbrook area as a kid, Mufford Road.
Right.
I remember the drive-in theater over there.
So his question is, what's the feasibility of putting a suspended footbridge over the town common to the north side of the river to open up additional green space, which is a great idea, except, you know, that's been discussed, and they were screaming about the amount of money it would cost to build a bridge across, and that would be very costly to build that footbridge. But now, let me tell you, if money was not a problem, you could find a way to do it. Maybe they could do it with private development funds.
Well,
you know, that would be a great idea. You could open up more green space to people who just wanted to walk across the river and then walk through River Park North, which is a very beautiful area. I hadn't been out there in years, but I used to take my son fishing out there. And, you know, it's a beautiful area that people really don't use much.
I grew up over there when it was an asphalt plant there where that pond was. That's how long ago that's been.
Right.
But, you know, it is a beautiful area. But my whole point is that we shouldn't be spending a lot of city money. We're spending city money everywhere. Get private development involved. Allen and the city council needs to get private development involved.
Yeah.
You know, I would rather drive my car across Green Street Bridge and go down Munford Road and drive my car over there. Some folks may prefer to walk across the water.
Yeah. But, you I mean, know, if you do think about it again, you know, I'm not advocating the bridge because, you know, you have to see what it costs. And I don't know how we I don't know how we'd pay for that. But let's just say that you were able to get that built. It would be a pretty long walking bridge. You know, I noticed last night when I was driving back into Raleigh last night, I noticed they've now built a footbridge over I-40 at South Point Mall. And I was thinking, man, how did they build that? And where'd they get the money from to build that? There's now a footbridge from the neighborhoods on the western side of I-40 that they can walk over I-40 over to all of the shopping areas over at South Point in Durham. But it shows you again, the money up in that area of the state, they got money to do that kind of stuff. But we don't have it down here.
Well, Henry, that would be a bridge. It's probably about a half a mile long.
Be a long bridge.
It needs to be.
It would be a long bridge.
River Park North.
Yeah, I think that might be tough to do. Maybe that would be phase two of the thing or something. But
well, we can build a little small marina down there. You know, get Army Corps to come in there and dredge out some of that stuff in the front where folks can put their boats in, go down the river to Washington.
Right.
There's a lot of things you can do, and private money can do that. But, you know, we can't keep spending city money.
I totally agree with that. I think the bridge idea is a great idea, but I don't know how you'd ever get that built. All right, thank you very much, Stan, for the call. Great ideas, and we appreciate your input. We got to get a break in because, Lindsay, we're way overdue with Lindsay, and she's up next. Lindsay will have news headlines from WITN next, and then we'll get back to this and discuss it some more if you want to get in at 561-8255. It's now or never. Give your input. The Greenville City Council is going to be talking about this tonight at the Greenville City Council meeting. You know, should we? Are you in the camp that we should not touch the town common? It's too pretty. It's green space. We shouldn't do anything to it. Or take a little piece of the town common down along the river, put some development in there, and try to create a touristy area for the city of Greenville. It's worked in other places. Would it work here? 561-8255. We'll come back.
Don't miss the incredible year-end savings at East Carolina Chrysler Dodge Jeep. We are overstocked with over 400 new Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram vehicles. We aren't only discounting the 2013 models, but the 14s as well. Jeep Patriots starting at only $15,990. Dodge Grand Caravan starting at only $19,990. Ram Quad Cab starting at only $26,990.
It's the big finish at East Carolina Chrysler Dodge Jeep across from the Cracker Barrel in Greenville.
Think you're in good hands with your insurance company? The same people who held your hand when you bought your policy might try to wash their hands of you the moment you file a claim.
We'll help you take matters into your own hands by making sure you know your rights, and we'll fight to get you the compensation you may deserve.
At Hardy & Hardy, we're serious about seeking justice on behalf of our clients.
Count on Hardy & Hardy, protecting the rights of the seriously injured.
Stallings Mobile and Mini Storage Company will deliver a storage unit to your home or business today. Stallings Storage is the only local company providing mobile storage units, 8x15 or 8x10, delivered to your site. If you are remodeling your home or office or need to store merchandise and inventory at your business, you need to call Stallings Mobile and Mini Storage. We deliver, pick up, and store it for you. It's that easy, and there's no need to send your business out of town when your mobile storage needs can be met right here with people you know. Stallings Mobile and Mini Storage is located in Pitt County on B. Stokes Road. It's a well-secured facility with a live-in manager. Fixed units range from 5 feet by 10 feet to 40 feet by 40 feet. We store boats, cars, anything you need. We are Pirate Supporting Pirates. Call Stallings Mobile and Mini Storage today at 321-2300. That's 321-2300.
Having a vision of what really matters is how we succeed. Keeping an eye on the ball, seeing all the things that we need. Focusing on the big picture, always striving to do what's right.
you're on the go, it's Trade Wilco. No matter where you go in Eastern Carolina, there's sure to be an attractive and always clean Trade Wilco Hess station nearby. For the absolute lowest prices on gas, groceries, and travel necessities, stop at any of the Trade Wilco Hess stations throughout Eastern Carolina. Keep your eyes on the road, but remember to look for the green and white Hess sign. The best part? No one supports the ECU Pirates more. So when you're on the go, it's Trade Wilco.
Talking about developing the town common, doing something down there. The Greenville City Council is going to bring that back up again tonight, and I suspect there are going to be some people who try to overturn even the work and planning and even talking about it that's been done. You know, there was a motion to not even bring in this consultant that they had originally hired at the last city council meeting. So what you're going to be seeing with the city council now is they're trying to undo a lot of the things that they didn't agree with in previous years with this new council. And then you got people like this. I just got an email from Jimmy. How about with the amount of money that's been spent, show them West Fifth Street, take them down the winding road about 2 a.m., let them see what Greenville's all about downtown on Saturday night about 2 a.m. See, that's what you're going to hear from a lot of naysayers and a lot of cynical people. You know, we got too much crime. There's too much going on. This is the way you take crime out, is to put better development in. Mm-hmm. And, you know, to be cynical and say, you know, show them West Fifth Street and all that, to me, is not fair. But you're going to hear a lot of that. You're going to hear that. And you're going to hear a lot of people say, well, it's all about greed and development. And I don't agree with that either. And of course, it depends on who gets their hands on it and how it's managed. Because there's no doubt there are some people who would look at that and go, you know what, I can make $8 million by developing down there. You know, but that's why the city has to have the right people in control of it. And I hope that's what they're talking about tonight. But we'd love to hear your ideas on develop or no develop the town common. 561-8255, 561-8255. We'll come back to the discussion in a minute, but let's get some news headlines in now. Lindsay, I'm sorry we're running late.
That's all
right. Suddenlink brings us our WITN news headlines. Here is Lindsay Fry.
All right. Good morning, Henry. Good morning, everyone. We'll take a look at some of our headlines this morning. Police are working this morning to figure out what led to an armed robbery and shots being fired at a local apartment complex. Greenville police say it happened at 7:45 last night at building 1506, apartment 18 of the Pirate Place apartment complex. Now, they say they believe the suspects and the victims know each other, and the incident was drug-related. Police say no one was injured. Officers were on patrol when the altercation took place. That's because they say they've had an increase of calls for service at Pirate's Place in the last few months. It's unclear how many people were involved, but stay with WITN and WITN.com for updates. Now, we'll also be following what happens in the courtroom today as a local teen is due back before a judge in connection with the accidental shooting death of his best friend. 19-year-old Michael Rouse is charged with involuntary manslaughter in the death of 20-year-old Randall Lewis. The Lenoir County Sheriff's Office says the shooting happened last month when deputies say the two were horseplaying with a gun. They say the gun went off, hitting Lewis in the head. Rouse remains in custody this morning, and we'll let you know what happens in the courtroom later on today. Well, a tragic end for a family on the way to watch a teenage boy play basketball. Troopers tell us the boy was electrocuted after an SUV crashed into a power pole. Troopers say around 12:30 Saturday afternoon on Highway 42 West of Harrell Road, a 2003 GMC SUV ran off the road and hit a utility pole, knocking it over. There were seven people in the car, including the driver, Amber Osborne. Troopers say when Osborne stepped outside, she felt a shock in her feet and her legs. As she tried to warn everyone else to stay inside the vehicle, witnesses tell the highway patrol that her 13-year-old son, Zachary Stoyer, stepped out of the SUV. That's when he came in contact with some power lines and was apparently electrocuted. Troopers say Stoyer fell to the ground, and after several failed attempts to revive him by CPR, were told that he died. No one else was seriously injured. Troopers say the group was headed to Stoyer's basketball game at the Hertford County Recreation Center. Well, that's your WITN News update. I'm Lindsay Fry. Henry, we'll send it back over to you.
All right. Thank you, Lindsay. Let's check the weather now. And very nice day today, but the end of the week looks a little weird. What we got, McGee?
Yeah, nice day today and for tonight, cloudy. Occasional rain, late lows in the low 50s, an 80% chance of rain coming in tonight, and we'll see most of that rain continue into Tuesday. Diminishing, though, by the afternoon hours with a high of 59 degrees for Tuesday night. Clear skies, lows in the upper 30s. Wednesday, we'll see a mix of sun and clouds, highs in the upper 50s and lows in the upper 20s. And Thursday, not quite sure what Thursday holds. Rain, we're seeing snow showers here, maybe highs in the upper 40s and lows in the low 30s.
Did you say snow showers?
I said it, but I don't know if I meant it.
You said it really fast. I didn't make sure.
Yeah, snow showers.
Snow showers.
What? I didn't say it. Or did I?
Could happen on Thursday.
It could.
News and weather this hour, a service of Suddenlink. Hey, they've continued their Share the Love program after the holidays here. If you switch up from Dish Network right now by visiting Suddenlink.com and you bundle and save, you can save $75 on your bill. And the person that recommended you can save $75, $25 per service. We're talking telephone, internet, and, of course, television, internet, and home phone. So that's the deal. $25 per service, a total of $75 off the bill for you, $75 off for them. When you refer a new customer to Suddenlink, you can find out more about the details on the Share the Love plan at suddenlink.com/referral for more information. Or you can switch up now by calling Suddenlink at 866-432-1184. And here's the other thing about Suddenlink. All these satellite networks now, they're you know, I was talking to somebody last week. They keep losing local channels because they can't make a deal with them. I guess Dish Network still doesn't have the local ABC affiliate, WCTI. That's been going on now for forever. And so if you're missing shows like Revenge and Scandal and stuff like that, which I don't watch those shows, but I hear those are really good shows. And so, you know, Suddenlink not having those problems. Call Suddenlink today and sign up 866-432-1184. Remember, there are no contracts with Suddenlink. 30-day, no-risk, money-back guarantee at Suddenlink. All right, 14 in front of 9 o'clock. Again, more conversation coming up about the Greenville Town Council. The City Council tonight is going to be undertaking more discussion about what to do or what not to do on the Greenville Town Common. What do you think they should do? Are you opposed to any development on the Town Common? 561-8255. 561-8255. I want to hear what you have to say next.
It's the final push to beat our all-time sales record, and Greenville Toyota will do whatever it takes. Hurry in today and get Toyota-thon savings before it's over. Final year-end payments as low as $148 a month and 0% APR financing. Plus, shop our huge selection of recently traded certified pre-owned vehicles. With the Greenville Toyota Advantage, every new Toyota comes with cover maintenance for life. And we're open Sunday, December 29th to hit our goal. We're almost at the finish line. Hurry in today and help Greenville Toyota set another record.
At the law firm of Hardy & Hardy, we don't simply take cases.
We take your case personally.
I've been in several car accidents, and each time I've turned to Hardy & Hardy for help. They are honest, hardworking, and dependable. I've been satisfied with the conclusion of each case, and I would recommend Wayne and Charles Hardy to my family and friends.
You matter to us.
Protecting the rights of the seriously injured.
Unlock the best life has to offer for generations to come. Introducing the Legacy Membership exclusively at Ironwood Golf and Country Club. As a Legacy member, you'll not only enjoy all the benefits of an active, family-friendly lifestyle, your children and grandchildren will enjoy membership status as well. Belonging to Ironwood is remarkable. Sharing it with your entire family is even better. Become a Legacy member today, only at Ironwood Golf and Country Club. Golf at its finest, life at its fullest.
Top Dog Academy is Eastern North Carolina's complete dog training facility. Top Dog provides an excellent environment for dogs of all ages with training services and workweek daycare. Top Dog is located on Highway 43 South, just 4 miles from Bells Fork, and features a comfortable, healthy environment and a spacious facility for daycare and a brand new, beautiful facility for training. Call 752-8215 or visit topdogonline.com.
Come on out Highway 43 South to Top Dog Academy, where we know dogs.
Okay.
Pepsi. Born here, raised by Panthers fans everywhere.
Raise your Pepsi for a chance to win the ultimate fan experience. See specially marked 18 packs or visit PepsiRaisedHere.com to learn more.
Many people in eastern North Carolina suffer from diabetes. The question is, can the disease be managed before it causes harm? Are there lifestyle changes that can help prevent it in the first place? And can a health system really make a difference? At Vidant Health, we are empowering people with tools and resources to detect and manage chronic disease. Can diabetes education and management help members of your family lead healthier lives? The answer is definitely yes.
All right, welcome back. Talk of the Town. It's 10 minutes in front of 9. One correction I need to make. There is a Greenville City Council meeting tonight, but I think this item, the City Council discussion and talking about this master plan for the town common may not come up until the City Council meeting Thursday night. Thursday night, you know, Thursday night's the long meeting where they have more of an agenda. They meet on Mondays and Thursdays on the weeks that they meet, but it's going to come up this week, so I'm glad we're talking about it. 561-8255. 561-8255 is the Town Common Master Plan. They passed this 3 years ago. Now some of the Greenville City Council members want to come back, revisit it, put it on the shelf probably. Marion Blackburn has asked that it be put back on the agenda for this week. Let's go to Eric. Good morning, Eric. How are you?
Good morning.
What are your thoughts about this?
Yeah, I would like to see that area be developed to promote what it is. Something like, you know, Charlotte's got an outdoor center with climbing walls, and we've got a beautiful area down there, and we've got a younger population in Greenville probably than the average of North Carolina, and we could promote some healthy outdoor living. We've got, you know, kayaking opportunities, paddleboarding, tours, eco tours, possibly a climbing wall. You know, this summer, me and my family was up in Mount Mitchell camping. It was a rainy day. We drove into Asheville. That town was littered with outdoor activities that you could do indoors, indoor climbing wall, and people were just everywhere, and that place was just full.
Yeah. You know, I mean, let's be honest. How often does the average person that lives in Greenville go to the town common? I mean, they talk about using it as green space and common area and all that, but I mean, the reality of it is it's used by a handful of people on a regular basis, and it's usually the people that live down around First Street.
Well, I probably go 3 or 4 times a year. Me and my kids go ride the Greenway. I don't know if you've got people who've got small kids, but it is a wonderful place. You know, it's almost 7 miles if you go all the way to the end and come back. It's a great place to take your kids cycling.
Well, let me ask you this, Eric. Would it enhance it or destroy it to put some development up on the river up there? And I'm talking about like a line of shops and restaurants.
You know, in my opinion, I would like to see it be developed to enhance what it is, an outdoor center. You know, I would like
So you'd be opposed to having any kind of retail or restaurants down there, but you're talking about some sort of a parks and recreation facility to promote kayaking and that kind of thing.
Yeah, and not necessarily kayaking. Like I say, you asked me earlier in the program, you said, a visitor comes to town, where do you bring them?
Yeah.
You know, you have a wonderful recreation center down there with all different types of recreation going on.
Right.
You bring them there and say, look what we got here.
Yeah.
You know, are you interested in climbing? Are you interested in kayaking? Or any other things, you know, that these developers might brainstorm on?
That's another good idea. All right. Thank you, Eric.
All right. Bye-bye.
561-8255. 561-8255. No development or some good development on the town common. Raymond, what say you?
Hey, I think it's a great idea. I'm a water fan myself, and I've always said for years that Washington and Greenville both have really fell behind in looking at one of their great assets, which is that river for development to draw more business in. And referring back to what Eric just said, I think that's a great idea, but at the same point in time, if we had some little restaurants and side shops down there to attract people along with the sports stuff would be great, too. I remember a few years back, when the out there on 264, where they used to have the driving range in the water.
Yeah, the big splash.
I remember the guy that originally bought that property, his envisioned plan was to put a marina there and put a restaurant in the middle of that lake and then have people go drive, take the boats, come in from Washington and places like that and eat. But then
how do you dodge the golf balls if you're having dinner over there?
Well, that was before they put the big splash there.
I got you.
And they were, but the Corps of Engineers wouldn't let them open that lake into the river.
All right. Well, thank you for your input. We're almost out of time. Let's try to grab a couple more. Velda? All right, Velda, good morning. You're on.
Hi.
Shoot.
I would like to see something for the children, like a small amusement park, like a little cotton candy and hot dog stand, and spend time with the children. It's a family environment.
But how do you draw people down there to use that?
Well, word of mouth.
Right. So you're talking about just have some small, like, kiosk kind of things.
Instead of a big fair.
Right. So you don't like the idea of restaurants and that kind of thing down there.
Well, a restaurant would be nice.
Yeah.
Not a drinking hole.
Oh, no. I agree with that. You have to be careful not to turn it into a part of the downtown nightlife scene. I totally agree with that.
Children need a place to run and to de-stress. It would be nice to have a place where children can do things with their family.
All right. Well, thank you for that. I appreciate it. Let's see. We left the switchboards full of people, and I apologize. We're out of time. Maybe we'll take this back up but tomorrow or later in the week, because this is a really good subject. And I do want to hear what people have to say. And the phones are still hopping, people still calling in. So this is a hot topic, obviously, that people want to talk about. We'll do it again later in the week as the Greenville City Council, again, they're meeting tonight, but I don't think it's going to be on the agenda tonight. It is on the agenda for Thursday night. But again, if you have an opinion about this, that gives you a few days to contact your city council person and let them know how you feel about this, because this is going to be a hot subject, I think, in 2014, what to do with the town common. All right, that's it for today. Everybody, enjoy your Monday and enjoy this nice weather, because it's not going to last, and we'll see you tomorrow.
Don't miss the incredible year-end savings at East Carolina Chrysler Dodge Jeep. We are overstocked with over 400 new Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram vehicles. We aren't only discounting the 2013 models, but the 14s as well. Jeep Patriots starting at only $15,990. Dodge Grand Caravan starting at only $19,990. Ram Quad Cab starting at only $26,990.
It's the big finish at East Carolina Chrysler Dodge Jeep, across from the Cracker Barrel in Greenville.
When you're on the go, it's Trade Wilco. No matter where you go in Eastern Carolina, there's sure to be an attractive and always clean Trade Wilco Hess station nearby. For the absolute lowest prices on gas, groceries, and travel necessities, stop at any of the Trade Wilco Hess stations throughout Eastern Carolina. Keep your eyes on the road, but remember to look for the green and white Hess sign. The best part? No one supports the ECU Pirates more. So when you're on the go, it's Trade Wilco.
Unlock the best life has to offer for generations to come. Introducing the Legacy Membership exclusively at Ironwood Golf and Country Club. As a Legacy member, you'll not only enjoy all the benefits of an active, family-friendly lifestyle, your children and grandchildren will enjoy membership status as well. Belonging to Ironwood is remarkable. Sharing it with your entire family is even better. Become a Legacy member today, only at Ironwood Golf and Country Club. Golf at its finest, life at its fullest.
Having a vision of what really matters is how we succeed. Keeping an eye on the ball, seeing all the things that we need. Focusing on the big picture, always striving to do what's right. Carolina Vision Care, we keep what's important inside.
Top Dog Academy is Eastern North Carolina's complete dog training facility. Top Dog provides an excellent environment for dogs of all ages with training services and workweek daycare. Top Dog is located on Highway 43 South, just 4 miles from Bells Fork, and features a comfortable, healthy environment and a spacious facility for daycare and a brand new, beautiful facility for training. Call 752-8215 or visit topdogonline.com.
Come on out Highway 43 South to Top Dog Academy, where we know dogs.
We'll do whatever it takes. Hurry in today and get Toyota-thon savings before it's over. Final year-end payments as low as $148 a month and 0% APR financing. Plus, shop our huge selection of recently traded certified pre-owned vehicles. Need financing? We can help. With the Greenville Toyota Advantage, every new Toyota comes with cover maintenance for life. We're almost at the finish line. Hurry in today and help Greenville Toyota set another record.